Thanks for tuning into a Christmas conversation with Open Arms International's U.S. Executive Director Kaytie Fiedler and special guest Daniel Sitenei. Daniel Sitenei is not only a native Kenyan, he is an international advocate for Open Arms International. Daniel spent 8 years on staff at Open Arms Village, where he oversaw numerous international teams and quickly became a beloved member of the community. In 2018, Daniel was accepted at Canby Bible College and moved to Oregon to begin his education. Currently, Daniel is studying at Monoma School of Bible and pursuing a degree in global development and justice. We hope you enjoy this Christmas conversation with Kaytie and Daniel.
Sir, easily. In the Sitenei family, how do you celebrate Christmas? When you're at home in Eldoret and you're with your family, how do you celebrate Christmas?
In Kenya, it's a time to come together as a family. But the real core thing is about remembering the birth of Jesus Christ. And because of that, we wake up early Christmas morning and go to church. And, of course, the scripture, the sermon that day will be about the birth of Jesus Christ and how and what that means to us as believers. And after which we go back home. We have a special meal of like chapatis with chicken and other good stuff right there. And eat together and get to enjoy together as a family. Sometimes we get together as extended family, but sometimes it can just be the normal family. Yeah. But yeah, again, it's special and it's something that we always look forward to. So, yeah.
What is your favorite Christmas dish? What do you like to eat the most? Maybe that your mama makes really good.
Chapati, of course.
Everyone loves chapati.
With beef.
Oh, with beef. Nice. Yeah. Oh, that's so good. And so this Christmas is a little bit different here, of course, because our families are not being encouraged to have too large of a gathering. Do you have the same restrictions that you know of in Kenya for this year?
I think the restrictions are still more or less the same. But it differs with the country depending on how the impact of the coronavirus on the country. So I'm not sure about the restrictions in Kenya compared to this place, but I'm hoping we can still be able to enjoy a good time. Yeah. During Christmas.
Yeah, I do too. You've been at Open Arms Village as Christmas season was happening. Do you have a memory from being at the village and seeing the kids celebrating Christmas?
Yes, I remember when I was in the village. I think almost the 8 years I was at the village, at Open Arms Village, I had the privilege of celebrating the Christmas with the children. And it was nice because I was involved in like organizing fun things to do with the children, playing, dancing, and eating a meal together. Apart from going to the field and playing soccer in the afternoons, but of course the children at the village were looking forward to this day because it's special. They get to get new clothes, and they get to get a special meal, and they get together and just enjoy themselves. It's always stunning. Yeah,
watching 157 kids celebrating Christmas. What a joy that must be.
It's a lot of joy.
Well, our supporters have been so generous this Christmas season, and we can't wait to share with everybody pictures and video of all of those celebrations that you're describing. And I do know that there will be, just don't tell anybody, there will be new footballs that will be distributed. Oh. They are in desperate need of footballs, or soccer balls, as we would call them here in the States, but desperate need of footballs. And oh my goodness, they're so talented, Daniel. Most of those kids, I mean, they could outrun and out foot maneuver kids here in the States easily.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the best thing they like doing. So I'm sure they'll be happy to receive those footballs.
Yeah, we're just having such a good time being able to see the staff there go and purchase items for the children, and especially having new clothes. So having a new set of clothing for Christmas, that's a big tradition in Kenya.
Yeah, that's a big tradition in Kenya, especially for young children. That's something they always look forward to. And if you don't get a new clothes for Christmas, that will not be a very good Christmas. So for children, yes, and it's really a big tradition. And I think it's also with the adults, but it's not as much as with the children.
Isn't that interesting? I didn't realize until I started working with Open Arms International how vital that was, getting a new set of clothes at Christmas for kids. Our kids here could care less about clothes. In fact, a lot of them open up the clothes and throw them aside and then keep looking for the toys. But it sounds like clothing is a very, very special gift. I'm so glad to know that. And I'm sure our listeners are glad to know that too. I know that you have been in the States now for, it's 2 years, yeah? That you've been in the States?
Yeah, two years and close to 4 months, yeah.
I can't believe it's been that long, Daniel. And I know that, you know, we've had conversations about the differences between Kenya and the U.S. and as you've adapted and settled in, which I'm impressed with how well you've done over here. Are there some things, especially during the holiday season, that you particularly miss about Kenya?
About the holiday season, it's just the aspect of like getting together with community and different people, like different families, different church members, is a thing that happens in Kenya, bigger than here. Okay, it's common here to have family and really friends get together, but it also in Kenya it's more of like more than just family. Like it's one big family with like the community. It's a just a happy time of like getting to enjoy as neighbors, as friends, and sometimes people can share meals. Like if they slaughtered a sheep today, then they will sometimes take some of that sheep and share it with the neighbor. And, you know, that's always special to always remember your neighbor and remember the people you live with and surround yourself with. Yeah.
That's such a good reminder for all of us to, especially this year when things are so rough for so many, to remember and share with our communities what we can. We may not be able to slaughter a sheep and share that with our neighbors, but we certainly can come up with ways that we can be a blessing to those around us. I really love what you're saying. That's a meaningful memory for you. Well, you were on staff with us for 8 years, which is impressive to me, and so telling of your character and your love for the children. And could you tell our listeners a little bit about how Open Arms International impacts the community? We're, of course, all very familiar with our kids at the village, and we've got 157 of them that we're caring for with education and food and medical. But you are someone who lived in the community, came to work at Open Arms Village, and knows some of the connections that we have outside of our gates that has blessed those that live near us. Can you tell us a little bit about how Open Arms has impacted the community in a positive way?
So like glad for Open Arms and what they are doing in Kenya, and they're doing a good job. And during my time when I was in Kenya and served with Open Arms for that period that you mentioned, 8 years, it was really a fun time, an impactful time for myself, and being able to be part and parcel of the dream and the vision and mission, to be able to reach and to love, serve, and be with the children. And in addition to the children, the community was just a powerful thing in my life. And I'm so thankful for that opportunity. But I'm going to mention like three ways that I think the Open Arms has been impactful to our community. And, you know, taking care, loving children and taking care of children is one big aspect of Open Arms. But being able to just not look at the children at the village was just a brilliant idea, whereby opening the door for the community children to also come to Open Arms Academy is a powerful thing that's happening. And I think of those children who come from the community and attend Open Arms Academy, and I've really benefited from the support of our donors and sponsors to be able to do school. So a few children from the community who were able to go to Open Arms Academy and succeed, and they are right now going to they went to good high schools, and right now they're continuing with their education in good colleges and universities. So that's a powerful thing that has really impacted the community. That's one of them. And then there was the brilliant idea of the silos, and I'm so grateful for Ted, who was part of our outreach team when I was there, because of the brilliant idea of making silos and behind it being able to store corn and grains in a good and safe way without using pesticides, and all those drugs used to preserve maize, is a powerful thing. And being able not only to just show them the skill, but also try and give them at an affordable price, and not just give them the silos also, but also train them to have the skills to be able to make silos for themselves, is a great thing that happened while I was there. And so I was able to see the people from the community appreciate that idea and be able to get silos for themselves. But also when we were out in the community and just seeing the people coming to learn about how the silo is important, and even the skills to build the silo with, was just powerful to see those people smiling and enjoying and learning. So that was big. So the third thing that really has been impactful in that community, also with our outreach team, and which was one thing also people like Ted and Brenda also did, was going to the community, and the entire outreach team when I was there is going to the community and being able to visit with these people, go into their homes, being able to sit with them and being able to share a meal with them and take the tea, take the chai, of course we call it chai, take chai and also take ugali and chapatis out there, and being able to share stories of different stories, aspects of the US and Kenya, and being able to learn different ways to grow together is powerful. I am a believer of like being able to sit down and share stories, because I believe stories are powerful. And so the aspect of going there and being with those people in their homes within their own community was powerful. So those are a few ways I can just mention.
Yeah, those are great examples. Definitely, the Academy has been a wonderful opportunity for us to help those children that don't need a home, but they certainly need a good quality education. And the Academy has grown to over 250 students. And sadly, it has been impacted by COVID, of course. We were able to open it to three grades back in October, and we had 48 students that were able to come back for specific grades. And of course, safely, we did all of the social distancing and sanitation requirements that were inputted in by the government. And that's gone really well. We've had no one get sick, and all the students are learning and passing their national exams very well. And then the government has said we will be open in January for school, starting January 4th. So right now the academy is getting ready to open its doors back to hopefully the 250 students that will come. And we've got the room, thank God, to host classes safely and abide by the guidelines. And the silos you mentioned, I didn't realize how really incredibly powerful that program is until just recently when I was there and I was helping Ted. And I knew about the silos. I did not understand the importance of keeping maize, keeping their grain pesticide-free and also bug-free and keeping it for a long period of time. It's very difficult to do, and it's expensive if you lose all of your maize. So the silo project is really an incredible initiative. And then the last thing I heard you say was just relationships. Being in people's homes, hearing their stories, and just being heard. You know, we all just want to be known and we want to be heard. And I just think that's such a great reflection, Daniel, of your time with us on staff and the empowerment that Open Arms has given to those in the community to educate, to provide some sort of industry for themselves, and also the relationship building. Those are great examples. Well, I know you're studying in school, so the last thing I wanted to ask you about is what you're getting a degree in and where you're going to school, and when do you anticipate graduating?
Okay, yeah. So, yeah, I'm going to school at Multnomah University, and I'm doing a master's degree in global development and justice, and trusting God to be able to graduate in 2022.
Amen. Mm-hmm. That's an excellent, excellent degree. I'm really excited. Do you have some sense of what you'd like to do with that degree when you're done, or are you still praying about it?
Yeah, right now I'm still praying about it, but my biggest desire is to be able to just do development and missions. That's what I know God has called me to do. And I'll take that direction. Right now, I don't know how that is going to look like, but yeah, I'm trusting God.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Well, yeah. I, for one, am extremely blessed to know you. And I know that Open Arms International has been blessed as an organization by your time on staff and the time that you've spent here in the U.S. being an ambassador for us while you're doing your studies, of course. So I always appreciate when you take time to give us your thoughts and reflections. And mm-hmm. I want to wish you a very Merry Christmas. Thank you so much for your time, Daniel.
Yeah, thank you for having me. And thank you for reaching out. I also wish you a happy or Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Thank you. How do you say Merry Christmas and Happy New Year in Swahili?
Okay, it's Christmas in Jema. Christmas in Jema is Merry Christmas. And then Mwaka Mpya Wenye Fanaka. I hope I'm saying it right. Mwaka Mpya Wenye Fanaka. So that is like Happy New Year, like Happy Prosperous New Year, something like that.
I like it. Well, most of us will not know if you said it wrong, so you'll get a pass from all of us. Well, God bless you, my friend. I look forward to seeing you soon, and you just enjoy all the family that I know you've had made here in the States. We sure do appreciate and love you, and God bless you.
Thank you so much, Kaytie.
All right.
God bless you, too.